Kelly. My name is Cheryl Peralt, and I am the host of the program. So I want to thank all of you for coming out this evening for a very exciting program that we have with our guest features here in the house. We have Thea Iberall, we have Raylinda Bode, and we have Lisa Brager out there. Lisa Brager is an award-winning poet, essayist, and educator. She has had a long career, which she enjoyed, as English professor and director of the undergraduate writing program at the Pine Manor College. Lisa also loves dogs, and I believe she told a short story about her dog last year here, which I fell in love with that story. And Lisa is also connected to dogs as a canine massage therapist. And she is working on her own collection of dog poetry as well. And she also works over at Roots and Wings Yoga and Healing Arts Center in Natick, and she provides workshops and consultation in the area of creative writing and poetry. And she also recently had a little seed of an idea to bring a poetry garden to Wayland, and she made that seed grow. And last year was the first of the debut of the poetry garden that was beautifully landscaped by a local landscaper who chipped in and helped set it up, and with stakes, I believe, of beautiful poems as part of the poetry contest that were there for a number of weeks. And that was covered well in the media as well. And Lisa is a woman that whatever communication she uses, whether it's through her writing or through her storytelling or just talking to her in a cafe, she is a very effective at captivating and telling a story that can make you laugh as well as cry. I don't know what she is bringing precisely tonight, but I want to welcome Lisa Brager.
Severely impaired woman who was full of life, energy, and a bit of mischief. As we arrived and walked the ominous corridor, we could see the approach of a shackled man wearing a blue Department of Corrections jumpsuit. He was accompanied by two armed guards. To Denise, this was laugh out loud funny. She couldn't contain herself, made high-pitched sounds of delight, tears coming from her eyes as she pointed and pulled on my coat to make sure I didn't miss this knee-slapping sight. My heart rate climbed. I could tell from the tightening jaws of the officer that the inmate was no easy-to-manage case. I kept watch on him too, the death look in his eyes. He lurched forward, spitting in Denise's direction and warned, laughing now, crying later, as she whisked away. Years later, I remembered that adage, laughing now, crying later, as I began my own mental journey that brought me face to face to lock eyes with something I knew had the potential to steal my life away. Yet, Among the initial tears, the characters and situations I encountered were of such comedic value, my writer friend Judith urged me to pen a book called Laughing Through Lymphoma. But considering most people wouldn't share Denise's humor over a shackled inmate, I expect nobody thinks of cancer as funny or could find side-splitting humor on the malignancy ward. We speak of cancer in hushed tones. My dad spoke of his diagnosis as, "I got the big C," never using the word. No one ever says, "I got a good one for you, listen to this." This one starts out at Harvard Vanguard and ends at the Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center on the hematology, oncology, and bone marrow transplant floor. Sound familiar? When the medical mystery tour began at Harvard Vanguard with my swollen lymph nodes, Annie and I exchanged knowing glances at the first ENT appointment. The doctor wore a black cocktail dress, heels, and her cough hair and makeup didn't instill confidence as she fumbled around the exam room. In our prejudgment, we decided she was better suited to operate the clubs with the other 20-year-olds. We referred to her as the cocktail waitress and held off on the surgical order to excise one of my nose. I've always been one to take the long look down whatever road I'm traveling, so I checked online for the credentials of Harvard Vanguard's oncology staff, particularly the physician I would be assigned to, someone I unfortunately recognized from a parking lot encounter. I pulled into a space next to a tired-looking Toyota and caught a glimpse of him in his lab coat, eating a bucket of Kentucky Fried Chicken at 8:30 in the morning. A rather strange and unwelcome sight on the way to gastroenterology. I feared the thought that if I had cancer, a word were acculturated never to utter, I would be under the care of a chicken eater and a cocktail waitress. My odds at this was obviously less than ideal. Thankfully, my best friend Wendy, best friend and chief researcher, hopped on the case and got advice from her longtime friend and college buddy who rose to the ranks of medical director at the BI. He made a referral, pulled a few strings, and voila, I was in the reassuring hands of people we quickly referred to as the A-team. And it turned out we needed the A-team, as it was discovered I had an aggressive stage 4 lymphoma with only months to live. In lumbered the captain of our A-team on her bum knee. Stocky, military-style haircut, she took charge. She had an entourage of young doctors, students, nurses, nurse practitioners who stood at attention as she spoke. I think she scared the cancer out of me. Whenever we went in the medical world and mentioned her name, people's eyes would grow wide, and with a mix of admiration and fear, they'd comment how everyone knows of the captain, her reputation being larger than life. I once admitted to a physician that she was the boss of me, and he confessed she was everyone's boss, even the boss's boss. But as the captain herself explained, you want an oncologist with a considerable degree of arrogance. For the next 3+ years, it would be aye aye, captain, following her orders to the T. The captain's plan was to destroy my cancerous immune system and build me a new one. Chemo followed by high-dose chemo, followed by the grand finale, a bone marrow transplant. Aye aye, captain, We got to know each other rather well as I learned the challenges of an immune system replacement. When Amy got the flu a week before my second to last inpatient chemo, the captain's orders were, throw the girlfriend the hell out. She wasn't kidding. We had to disinfect the house with hospital grade sanitizer and ship Annie off to her sister's, captain's orders. For good measure, she added, and have her take the damn dog too. As it was, I could no longer allow the dog to sleep in bed, couldn't pat her unless I wore latex gloves. I once made the mistake of asking the captain if I could kiss the dog, to which she said, you mean French? No, no dog kissing, and left the room waving her hand with the captain's usual flair. However, I occasionally broke that rule, and as luck would have it, Annie caught on camera the big dog tongue across half my face and used it for blackmail. She'd dangle it over my head and quip, you know who I could send this to? I learned later from the social worker that most patients had a don't tell the captain photo of puppies, cats, babies, even a parrot and baby goat. We learned the ropes. We learned the ins and outs of the ER, the manner and style of the captain's team, everyone from the docs to the candy stripers, and most importantly, we learned the daily rhythms of inpatient critical care. It's not uncommon to expect suffering on the inpatient oncology floor. So when I went in for my last high-dose chemotherapy treatment, a three-day stay for a concoction called Hydec, I knew what I was in for. I was confident, almost cocky, as I prepared for a couple of bad days, followed by a few bad weeks. My attitude at the time was, I got this. Piece o' cake. High fives to familiar staff as I checked in with my overnight bag of toiletries and silk dog pajamas. I palmed a few extra packets of saltines from the patient lounge on the way to my room, the one that was close to the solarium and had a Brookline Avenue view. My friend Wendy, who has nervous tendencies, came along just in case we needed someone to pull a Shirley MacLaine in terms of endearment, if need be. We hung up coats, got comfy in the empty double room, adjusted the reclining guest chair and bed by the window. We got out iPhones and, like dorm room co-eds, started texting and chatting, which provided the comfort of normalcy and distraction from the scarlet sea I carried in my lymph system. We were almost to ordering the veggie pizza and double desserts from the hospital menu to add to the dorm-like ambiance when Ginger, the nurse practitioner, came to the room with her spiky bleached blonde hair and cat-rimmed glasses to announce, space is tight, you'll be getting a roommate. A roommate? The words sounded strangely incoherent. I could see reading Wendy's face, she was on the verge of a Shirley. Ginger had that look of apology. My heart sunk, and the only consolation going forward was that I already staked out the bed closest to the bathroom, the room inside the room where, as soon as the chemo began, I'd be locked in full embrace with the toilet bowl. This was not a situation I could imagine sharing with another human being. But Gladys came. She came with her rolling suitcases of homemade food and Tupperware containers that filled the room refrigerator. This wasn't her first picnic either. She knew everyone and everyone knew her, everyone except me. At her first sight of me, she quickly snapped the curtain shut between us and announced, "I am a very private person." 10 minutes later, she snapped the curtain open and gave me the long version of her life story. As the medicine hanging on the IV pole slowly dripped into the line that led straight to my heart. Drip, drip, drip. The he said, she said details of her story spun along circular patterns as I anticipated the inevitable onslaught of non-stop nausea. Gladys had many needs and people to care for them. She was on the phone with her son. She kept the TV on and plugged in a portable radio, everything going at once. She called for the nurse to get her Tupperware meals heated in the microwave, another nurse for tea and toast, and cafe workers to bring salads and desserts. All this while friends came from all corners of the hospital to visit. She was in full party mode. When the first bag of chemo emptied into my system and I got temporarily unhooked from the IV pole, the production of mealtime began. For me, it was saltines and ginger ale that I shuffled around on my bed tray like unmatchable puzzle pieces that went nowhere and got frustrating to look at. But out from one of Gladys's many suitcases came her tablecloth and utensils from home to formally adorn her table, cafe style. And before the nurse entered the threshold of the doorway with Gladys's meal fresh out of the microwave, the aroma entered and thickly filled the room with a smell something halfway between carnival fried dough and extreme low tide. First course, cod salted something or other. A smell you couldn't escape no matter where you went on the floor. There were side dishes as well. Green sautéed in bacon fat, brain fritters, snails, oxtails, and a little secret something she called hoochie coochie, made from conch simmered in hot peppered rum sauce and deep fried. Gladys' celebrity status was in part due to these culinary elaborations, and I soon learned she had been the owner and head chef of a Haitian restaurant somewhere downtown. This was the reason for the long parade of visitors that entered the room for tastes and recipe sharing, which, under different circumstances, might have been an interesting enrichment to my vegetarian sensibilities. To each new person entering the room, Gladys rattled off the how-tos of pickling pig feet, of back pat fat and knuckle meat, and over again, her favorites kept coming out of the mini fridge. They were heated up by nurses who by this time were running around like waitstaff during a crazed dinner rush, trying to make their way to the room through the crowd of people to bring ice or the next heated side dish or more tea, extra glasses for visitors, additional butter slabs. As overconfident as I was coming into the last of the inpatient chemo treatment, nothing really prepared me for Gladys. But I grew to love Gladys. Even when no one was around, she'd put on her best wig, wrap herself in a colorful scarf, spray floral-scented perfume all around the room, and sing along with great gusto to the Haitian radio hour. When the late hours drew near and the party died down, Gladys was content arranging her wigs or talking on the phone, calling for the nurse for more pillows or extra blankets, all the while her TV and radio kept on. She talked mostly to her son or to her friend from her last job, and more than once I heard her explain that this was her first hospital stay, sharing a room. how she tried to get a single but couldn't, and how it really turned out okay because I was so quiet it was as if no one else was This sure gave me food for thought, and there was much about our dissimilar styles that inspired ideas about how to be in the world. Gladys was dying of leukemia. Many people who face illness or medical situations, some serious or otherwise, often console themselves and say, "Well, thank God it's not cancer." But when it is cancer, I learned the same rules of ordinary life apply. Laugh often, love deeply, and live each day as if your one wild and precious life depends upon it. After all, there was much to celebrate as I went through treatment. The wonderful people I met and those who stayed by my side and cared for me. At home, the birds came to the feeders through the long winter and provided endless entertainment. My journals are filled with the cardinal's bright color against the snow-covered yews or the woodpecker varieties, those frequenters to the hanging suet. The hawks predictably flew their patterns over the lake at roughly the same time each afternoon, and many days my spirits soared with them. Each day, no matter the weather or the body's condition, the heart of the world is somewhere rejoicing.
Storytelling, true storytelling now, with Raylinda Woad, who came from Salem far away with the blinding snow. And Raylinda is a longtime, highly respected Boston area storyteller. And I'll tell you a few things about her. Not only is she an artist of story, but she studied art at Mass Art College and focused on interrelated media, and then became a professional storyteller and began performing stories, like true stories that haven't quite happened. Raylinda has one CD at least, more? No CDs, but they're wonderful. So maybe you look on Etsy or talk to her after. And Raylinda also created and hosted the well-known Story Lab over at Club Passing in Harvard Square. And that was a spoken word concert of story and some poetry at times. Or,
everything was poetry.
Everything, yes. Raylinda in her bio notes, "None of which paid the rent." So she started a business with her metal work and jewelry of making tiny little book-shaped pins with tiny little imagination-shaped stories hidden inside them. Case in point, I have one, and you can open up her jewelry that she makes with welding tools. What's that?
Riveting,
okay. And so you have the metal work of her art on the outside and then inside are little stories and messages as well. And in the bio here it says her story with pins are worn by hip librarians, and I will add, and many other hip people around the globe. And my last point about Raylinda before she begins her story is that she arrived on the earth a few years ago as of Sunday. Sunday, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Solar circumnavigation ends and begins on Sunday.
So let's give a hand. Happy birthday.
Yeah.
Houston, we have a problem. And by Houston, I mean my autonomic respiratory system, and by problem, I mean I'd stop breathing. Yeah, stop, full stop. Like my two lungs decided, another time, and just clocked up.
Well, this was incredibly inconvenient because just moments ago, I'd been drifting in and out of sleep when I felt this invisible force grab hold of my legs and yank. And my legs started moving, people. I mean, they were accelerating forward towards the foot of the bed at incredible speeds. O.M. Insert alternative deity of your choice here, exclamation point. I was having a wild, awake-induced lucid dream, which often took the form of an OB, an out-of-body experience, where your dream body just sort of, you know, pops out of your waking body and just goes off and has a dream adventure. Hooray! But then I started thinking, shouldn't I be out of my body by now? Come on, what's the holdup? Let's get this dream rolling. Well, the holdup was, while my dream legs were just zipping along, the rest of my dream body just seemed stuck. So I tried to get it moving by thinking encouraging, out-of-body, floaty thoughts like, off you go, come on, torso, shoulders, arms, it'll be fun, head, come on. And that's when I noticed that there didn't seem to be any air moving through my body, which led me to notice that my chest wasn't moving. I tried to ignore it because I knew that sleep paralysis can make you feel like you're not breathing, but it's actually a natural nightly occurrence, something your sleeping brain does to kind of lock down your muscles before you go into REM sleep so you don't act out your dream. It's like an emergency break for your body. Harmless, ignorable. But even as I tried to ignore it, I could feel something building up in me with the inevitability of a sneeze. And suddenly, I sucked in air and they were off. My lungs, in, out, and I was awake. Awake like you were suddenly in your house, and your house is asleep, and you accidentally stumbled out of your house, and the door slammed behind you and locked, and the key was inside, that much awake. Awake. But not discouraged. I mean, after all, I was on a 1-year journey to become a lucid dreamer, and there were bound to be setbacks. And what I just tried, it's very hard to have a wake-induced lucid dream. It's not for newbies. Before you can wild, you have to dial. And before you can do that, you have to know what the heck I'm talking about. So, in case you don't know, a lucid dreamer is someone who falls asleep and starts dreaming like you do when you're asleep. But then, they begin to look around their dream reflectively, like you do in your sleep. And they go, wait a minute. How do I know any of this is even real? Was that barista always a unicorn? Busted! It's a dream! Classic dialed. Dream-induced lucid dream. Well, okay, it's not that easy. Or at least not for me, because I'm a classic Pisces. I'm even more gullible when I'm asleep. So for me, unicorns making lattes over at Starbucks, why not? They got elves making cookies over at Peter's. They got trolls making travel bands over at the White House. So in order to catch myself at dreaming, I started to do these reality checks during the day. And there's actually an app for it. So throughout the day, my iPhone will chime and the following words will appear on the screen. Are you dreaming? And that is my cue to stop, look around, and question my assumption that everything isn't a dream. Because as any lucid dreaming guidebook will tell you, if you want to be able to question reality in your sleep, you have to get into the habit of doing it while you are awake so that that habit will carry over into your dreams. And while this is absolutely true, it's also ironic Because lucid dreaming was originally developed thousands of years ago by Tibetan monks as a way to use their dreams to train their minds to question reality while they were awake. And it's called dream yoga. The Tibetans believe that dreams are a double illusion. Illusions generated by your sleeping mind, which, while awake, is part of the greater illusion that is this world that we all allegedly live in. Only ancient Tibetan monks could make that level of paranoia seem so cool. So, through meditation practices, they would train their minds to remain conscious while they were sleeping so that they could see through the illusions of their dreams. And by the time they woke up in the morning, their minds would be so buff from questioning reality all night that their first thought upon waking up in the morning, before they even had a cup of coffee, was, busted. Life is but a dream. So I thought, when I started doing these reality checks, that questioning reality was going to be super easy because, spoiler alert, from the ancient Tibetan monks, reality isn't even real. But I quickly ran into a problem. Reality might not be real, but it sure feels real. And whenever I tried to question it, it questioned me back. Like one time, I noticed this rock that kind of looked like a potato. And I thought, that potato rock looks weird. Could I perchance be dreaming it? And I could practically hear the rock laughing at me going, honey, I've been rocking this potato for a chameleon years before you were even born. And I'll still be here doing it a gazillion years after you're nothing but dust. But you just go on telling yourself that I'm the dream. Have you ever been mocked by a rock? I mean, it's kind of humiliating. Plus, I had no idea that granite could be that snarky. I mean, from quartz, I would understand because of the whole new age thing. You know, like your quartz, you're peacefully sleeping in the ground for the past trillion years, and suddenly a bunch of strangers reeking of patchouli show up with names like Chakra Blossom Number 7. And they dig you up and they drag you to some new age expo where they display you on a jewelry tray like you're a piece of salmon that just got put on sale. And now, Dances with Dolphins Number 29 is telling a prospective customer that you can cleanse their aura, summon their true love, hook them up with their personal guardian angel, and get them a reason to work. And you're lying in your tray trying not to panic, going, well, what now? I gotta do what now? Lady, I'm just a rock. I mean, okay, if you throw me in a pond at a shallow enough angle, I may skip a few times before I sink, but that's it. That's my one big move. Well, and when I hit the water, I will cause ripples to form, and those ripples will expand in ever-growing circles that won't stop when they reach the shore. They'll just kind of transfer their energy into vibrations and keep moving through the atmosphere, passing through the membranes in between worlds, keep going, keep growing in power and influence until a gazillion years from now, they are filling empires, crushing civilizations, birthing new life forms, and inspiring somebody to make a recipe for a cream cheese brownie donut that will blow your mortal but mainly, I'm just a rock. So could I please go back to sleep now? Anyway, that's what I would have expected from boys. I just thought granite would be a little more chill. I did eventually find a reality check that worked for me on the internet. And I have to say, when I first read it, I thought, no, no way is this real. But it is. It's real. So if you ever suspect that you or someone you know could be dreaming, what you want to do is grab your nose and pinch your nostrils closed tight. We're talking NASA space station airlock tight. And then try to inhale through your nose. If you can breathe, you're dreaming. It's weird, but apparently when you're dreaming, your brain is basically modeling a reality for you to inhabit in real time, and that is hard. So it's always cutting corners and fudging, and you can catch it if you know what to look for. And apparently it never catches that discrepancy that if you hold your nose closed, you shouldn't be able to breathe. So when you dream about breathing, it models breathing. So one morning I woke up and I thought, ugh, and yet another night of failing to lucid dream. And then I noticed that something felt a little off. Like my body felt 5% larger, or perhaps the room was 5% smaller, and I thought, could this be a dream? No. This is my bedroom. There's Charlie, my pet octopus. But then I thought, maybe just to keep the habit rolling, I should do the test. So I grabbed my nose, and I inhale, and I felt cool oxygen flowing through my black nose into my lungs. I was so surprised, I almost woke up before I could finally go, Now, a lot of lucid dreamers will tell you that their lucid dreams are exactly like real life, only you can control them. Maybe. I mean, I believe most of the people who say that, but that's not what it's like for me. For me, waking up inside a dream is like waking up inside a Chagall painting. Everything is just drifting and shifting and transforming, including my own self-awareness, and I have to work very hard to maintain it. And at first, I was disappointed that I wasn't getting those sort of, you know, HD-level lucid dreams, but recently I've come to accept it and even appreciate that that's what it's like for me. I mean, why go to all the trouble to push the edge of consciousness just to experience the same old thing you could get when you're awake? Although, one of my most recent lucid dreams was pretty lifelike, but I think it was because it started with a false awakening. Now, for some weird reason, whenever I become lucid, the first thing I want to do is either jump out a window or fall off backwards off a roof. And I can't explain why, because I am terrified of heights when I'm awake. I couldn't even wear platform shoes in the 70s, and I love Elton John, but there you have it. So one morning, I was in my bathroom brushing my teeth, when I noticed that my toothbrush was as big as a push brick. Well, that ain't right. Busted! Where's the roof? I want to jump. So I was dashing out of my bedroom to get to my roof deck when I caught a glimpse of myself in the mirror, and I thought, whoa, I can't jump just like that. Have you ever had a morning where you just can't find the right outfit, and you keep putting things on and making them off until you've tried on everything and nothing feels right? I was having that sort of a morning, and I hadn't even woken up yet. Well, finally found a shirt I liked. In fact, it was a shirt, but I couldn't decide on the pants, and all the while I was acutely aware of time going by, because lucid dreams don't last very long, and I was wasting mine. And finally I thought, okay, just pick something and jump. So I grabbed a pair of pants. I could see the outline of the shape of the pants, but all the details were completely blacked out, like they existed simultaneously in another universe that was pitch black. Now, I get this visual glitch sometimes when I'm dreaming. One time I looked in the mirror, and my body looked normal, except for my face, which was entirely blacked out. First roof, I want to jump. But I got the pants on, and I went over to the window, because it was closer, and I stepped off of the windowsill, and I stepped off, and in the way of dreams, I stepped onto the roof of a giant camper that was in the woods. And below me was a tribe of patriarchal Luddites. Now, you just know these things in dreams. It's like your dreaming brain doesn't want to waste time on exposition, so it just does these data dumps. So, oh, patriarchal Luddites, got it, okay. Fortunately, I could see that, sort of. And I knew that the other side of the woods was a beautiful stream, and if I could just reach it, it would take me someplace better. Well, I managed to reach it, but whoops, change of plan. The stream was now a highway packed with abandoned cars. Pause for another data dump. Oh, that's right. Civilization fell a few days ago, and everybody had to abandon their cars and go live in the woods. Damn. Trapped between Luddites and the apocalypse. Damn. But in dreams, things change fast, and suddenly the highway was railroad tracks, and the cars were sailboats attached together like a train with wheels on their keels. And I saw a man, a head sailboat, and he looked very jolly, like a conductor. And I said, where's all this going? And he said, I'm taking these sailboats to a community of progressive liberals who are going to fix them and get civilization up and running. And I said, really? Can I come? And he said, sure, hop aboard. So I climbed on the sailboat, and I sat down in the cockpit near the transom. And we started to roll, and I thought, this is as good as it gets. I mean, I love sailboats. I love train rides. I'm on a sailboat, on a train ride. I should just wake up right now. But before I could, I was joined by a man. He sort of looked like an anorexic Malcolm Gladwell. And we started chattering excitedly, like two American tourists who find themselves in an exotic foreign locale, and they just can't stop congratulating each other on how exotic and foreign it all is. Like, isn't this an amazing dream? Yeah, did you see the light? Ooh, yeah. And then we started talking about lucid dreaming. And he kind of took over the conversation and said, he told me he was an expert lucid dreamer, and that when we got to our destination, which suddenly had become a luxury resort hotel, I should pay attention to him, because he was going to have a lucid dream, and I would see how it was done. And I thought, oh, he thinks he's the one dreaming, and I'm his dream character. I wonder what he would say if I told him that the opposite is true. I'm 99% sure.
Novel, The Swallow and the Nightingale, which is a way to wake people up to the real moral issue of today, not who you love, but what are you doing to the planet? And there are some copies over there this evening. And as a little extra additional information, she's very busy and creative, as you can see, in many different areas, and has also a PhD in computational neuroscience. So here to share her story of what we celebrate and what her theme she is focused on, her topic in that theme. We have Thea. Please give her a hand.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? Yes. Someone said everything's a gift. I'm playing tennis in the rain, wondering what gift I'm getting. I mean, today's my father's 85th birthday. This is his mandolin. I can always tell my father by who's doing the talking. He's godlike. He's truth-seeker. And he knows all. When asked what fossil is this, he can respond with the age of the Earth and prove that iron rust rests on Mars and 42 billion-year-old rock roses. He predicts the death of our greedy civilization. In the same breath, he predicts my future. He manipulates the laws of physics in the same way he takes responsibility for choices I could have made throughout my life. God controls the universe and creates all living species, but he betters God by providing the equations for everything from the start of the universe to what invention will make me rich. When I ask for clarity, I get 5 billion years of homeokinetics, which is different from homeostasis because it's about how things change. But he never changes. He's always the same, knowing all that there is. I think he taught me math and science from even before I could walk. I mean, I remember in the sixth grade, they tried this experiment. It was so special. The principal, Mr. Purcell, was in the room with us, and Ms. Keynes was up at the blackboard writing out these equations that were incomprehensible to all the other students. Hell, it was just algebra. But it wasn't so much what he taught me. It was how. He called it the Socratic method. I called it something else. Today we'll learn Newton's laws of motion, the dynamics of power. Force equals mass times acceleration. Potential energy equals mass times acceleration times distance. You've got potential, but you are stupid. You are stupid. He'd poke at me for emphasis. I'd stare at the half-drawn curtains at their gold geometric pattern. Power equals force times time times stupid. This is my gift to teach you science, statics, static equilibrium, dynamics, dynamic equilibrium, kinetics, homeokinetics, which is different from homeostasis, because it's about how things change. But he never changes. It's always the same, knowing all that he is. He said to me, a body at rest remains at rest unless acted on by an outside force. I don't think he kept meaning to hit me. He just wanted me to learn Newton's laws of motion, the dynamics. But you see, I'm a truth seeker's daughter, and in my own way, I'm just like him. I too am godlike, and I know the truth. No one can predict my future or give me a past. And bare rocks and equations can be offerings of love. When I get out of my own way, I see that he's not God, but that he stands behind God, and I'm viewing him through the light of God. I remember the day he taught me to ride a bicycle. A theoretical physicist and a six-year-old. Angle your right pedal, he says, as he calculates the amount of force necessary to overcome the bicycle's inertia. P, inertia, equals 1/2 mass dot radius squared. It's a kind of laziness, inertia is, the unwillingness of objects to change. My bike is green with big tires. He continues. To achieve a rolling velocity of 3 meters per second, you need a force of 5.76 newtons, or kilogram meters per second, per second. I like my bike. Thirty-six years later, he buys a blue bike with a white seat on it, and we're staring at it, and he turns to me, and he's on a bike.
and he says, "How do you ride this thing?" And I'm realizing he's never ridden a bike before. The alley is narrow, concrete with speckled stones, and I'm trying to remember that thing about mass dot radius and that lazy thing about Newton. "Angle your right pedal," I say. As he pushes off, his hands curved over the curl of his handlebars, his feet pumping like the wings of the boy who flew too close to the sun, and his tires wobbling the way the earth wobbles on its axis every 23,000 years. And I'm playing tennis in the rain on what would have been my father's 85th birthday. Aristotle said, in the absence of forces, all objects come to a state of rest. And I'm remembering how still a body at rest can be, how a face and legs can become cold like the north wind, and a little finger can remain bent just so. I hit the ball, my tennis racket overcoming gravity with a force of maybe 5.76 newtons, like all objects wanting to resist change, but realizing everything isn't here. So that's my dad. The other person I celebrate is my mom. My mom, she was born in Harlem to Jewish immigrant parents. At the time, in 1913, when there was no cars and 120,000 horses in the city. And I take her, when I do these plays, We Did It For You, I do play reading workshops, and I bring her to the workshop with me, and she's sitting there, she's over 90 years old, and she's with this 20-year-old, and I put them all around in a circle, and they're ignoring her, and I hand them all the script. And there's 20 historical characters in the play, and we start reading Dolly Parch to it. And we get to Eleanor Roosevelt, and my mother jumps up and says, "I knew Eleanor Roosevelt! I worked with her in the canteens in Washington, D.C. during World War II. And we would make sandwiches for the soldiers, and I would tell her, 'Mrs. Roosevelt, you go out, you dance with the boys.' And then afterwards, they would make, when the soldiers left, we would have lunch together, and we had fried chicken, and I'm picking it up like that's how we did in my house, and Mrs. Roosevelt is eating it with knife and fork, and I have to start learning how to eat fried chicken with a knife and fork too." And the kids are all like, "Wow." No, the play continues, and then we get to Bella Abzug, and my mother says, "Oh, Bella, I knew Bella. Her husband was best man at our wedding. And when they came to New York, we would have dinner with them, and Bella would order lobster, and I'd say, 'Bella, how could you? It's not kosher.' And Bella said, 'Try it. You lie.' And I did, and I loved it. I ate lobster ever since." And then we'd finish the play reading, and I'd say to my mom, "So who's the first president you voted for?" And she said, "Franklin Delano Roosevelt, of course." And then I said, "And how old were you when women got the right to vote?" And the kids are like, "What? Voting? That's a right that grew with the dinosaurs." And I look at my mom and she says, "I was 7 years old. I remember my mom and my aunts being all excited that they could finally vote." And the kids are like, you can see this realization on their 20-year-old faces, realizing that history was not so long ago, and that these rights just don't grow on trees. And so they all wanted to jump in and do this play all over again and really understand what's going on. So then my mom turned 100 years old, and we had a party.
We had five parties for her. There's the big things, the yeses on the invitations, and the airplane flights, the crowd of relatives singing happy birthday, the 100 candles on the cake, how we figured out she's older than Mickey Mouse, yo-yos, even bird's eye frozen peas. They all wanted to come, her cousins and siblings, and they all did. Except for her younger brother, who was too sick to travel, so we Skyped him in from New Jersey. But someone said it was the little things that count. And I started thinking about what I remember most from the week-long party. And it's this. The night before everyone arrived, my mother and I are alone in the kitchen, and she tells me that she tests herself to keep her brain going. As you see, she's afraid of forgetting our faces and names, the way her favorite aunt from the old country did when she went to visit her at the nursing home. My mother's standing by the stove. A skylight brings us everything we need. And she tells me one of her tests is to memorize the lyrics to songs. And she starts to sing. Are you lonesome tonight? Do you miss me tonight? Are you sorry we drifted apart? She shifted her weight from foot to foot, imagining, I imagine, my dead father, young and virile. And the night Frank Sinatra sang it at the Copa with Tommy Dorsey's band. I get up and I gather her into my arms. And we dance, gliding to her voice in the space created by the gray granite countertops, corralling us into our own private dance hall. I watch our breath, how we breathe and rock, trying not to drift, but to focus on every story in her face and the brown laugh in her eyes. This munchkin of a 100-year-old mother who can't figure out the voicemail on her cell phone or understand how it's possible to be singing to her dying brother across billions of cyber atoms, her head tilted sideways, remembering that little boy that once peed down a pipe and the time he told her it'd break her heart if she went to the nursing home, but she did anyway, and how she curled up into Aunt Malka's bed and sang a lullaby in Lithuanian to her, trying to regrow those confided teenage secrets in that decaying brain. And for one second, it worked. And so now, how she practices the skill of remembering so that frozen Mickey Mouse stares won't stumble a distance between us, and I'm praying it won't. But just in case, I'm learning Lithuanian and Tivoing at night. I sang with the master and danced for eternity in the light of the moon. And then my mother turned 101. And then she turned 102. And she started going downhill at that point. And I started living with her. And she's lying there in her crossword puzzle pajamas with words going up and down her legs in little boxes, words like huggable, I love you. And U's and V's are intersecting in round little hearts, like stretching like arms. And I go to the blinds and I open them and I see the rising sun and I greet Saddleback Mountain. And then I go to her bed. And we do our ritual that we do every single morning. I kiss her on the left cheek, and then I kiss her on the right cheek, and then I say geschmack, which means delicious in Yiddish. And then we kiss some more, and then we hold hands. And then she recites an excerpt from a poem by Thomas Carlyle that she learned in the fourth grade, when she sat in the first row, first seat for being so smart. Here hath been dawning another blue day. Think, wilt thou let it slip uselessly away? And then we squeeze our hands as hard as we can and we say, no way. Sometimes she's in the kitchen in her house coat. Sometimes she's got her glasses on. Or sometimes we just do it on the phone when I'm traveling. In ancient times, they say that women to conceive babies would stand in the river facing east. Mothers maneuver wriggly things into focus. They coax curiosity from footsteps of fear. Why do we say one is only a mother when we should say this is a mother? She has dreams she can't sustain, a suspended symphony of her dying siblings. She once invited me into a sauna because I was so sad, and we sat there in the dry heat, naked, and I told her all my problems, and she took the necklace off of my neck that was burning into it, and the silence held our breath like sunlight on Dionysus' curls. 9 months after her 102nd birthday, she went into hospice. We gathered around her and she sang to us, "Show me the way to go home." When she couldn't sing anymore, we sang to her, "May the good Lord bless and keep you." And even though she couldn't speak, we still did our ritual. Her skin felt like raindrops. Her eyes held mine fiercely. "Here hath been dawning another blue day. Think, wilt thou let it slip uselessly away?" No way. The last day, the morphine put her into a stupor, and I sang to her the whole day, songs in Yiddish, in Hebrew, that were from her childhood. I looked up, she was mouthing the words. In her gaze, her eyes were unbound like photons, and our intersecting hearts spiraled halfway to sunrise. We braced for the weight of her passing. She left us with shadows, the memory of her hands, the lesson of her breath, and all the gratitude that she wrapped up in her thin dying arms. Out of eternity, a new day is born. Into eternity, from night will return. Behold it aforetime, no eye ever be it. So soon it forever from all eyes is hid. Here hath been dawning another new day.